Am I not the dragon of the sea? This pearl belongs to me. Those fools sought to steal it and trick an old hermit. But I learned of their plan, waited for their watery caravan, stirred up the frothing wave to be their vessel's prey. Do not toy with me. I do not take any plea. In my realm, I rule and do not suffer any fool to commit to steal my possessions or commit such transgressions against me. My minions deal quite harshly and punish any meddlers severely.
Please, tell me, if you can, please tell a weary man what this place by the sea, such a bleak, wild place, may be.
You have come to Shido, where the ocean winds blow, and the coves are deep below, and the coves are deep below. What brings you to this village near to our small cottage?
I've been on a long journey, with none for company, without guidance or a map, and have survived many a mishap.
What was in your mind? What did you hope to find?
My father's spirit wanders from his grave, where he ponders, did he deserve no honors? I have gone to find a cure, and that has been the lure.
What makes you think it is here? Why do you persevere?
What I search for is in the sea. It would set my father free. But I have not found it anywhere, and I am now close to despair. Is there an inn where I may stay until I can survey how the tides and currents lay?
In a small cabin by the sea, my mother lives and me. We have a spare bedroom. I don't mean to presume, but it is possible that you could stay until you go again on your way.
That is a most generous offer to make to a mere stranger. You have a generous heart. In return for the favor, I could help with things to do. Perhaps add something of value.
Come, I will talk with my mother. From here, it is not much further.
Tamatori began a magical journey. They walked along together, each feeling light as a feather. They came to a small abode, a narrow, winding road. There, Tamatori asked Fukito to wait while she talked to her mother in private.
I have met a very nice young man from a distant part of Japan. He has come to find something to honor the soul of his dead father. He says the answer lies in the sea. He comes here as a refugee.
My dear daughter, let us concede that you might misperceive his intentions to do us harm with his strong, manly arm. And how can we feed him at table? Our larder is empty but a fable.
He knows we're poor. Food he will help us procure. He seems very kind and quite gentle. He wears his dignity like a mantle, and comes on a magnanimous errand, not like some thieving brigand. Please, mother, do not say no. Please do not make him go.
My daughter, I cannot give you much, so you may welcome him to our hutch. I pray that he make you happy and not make your mother unhappy. Bring him in, have him sit down. We will wear a smile and not a frown, and prepare to serve a fish stew for the company of us few. And maybe we'll learn more about why he has come to our door.
Mother, you'll not regret it, and I'll never forget it. you're welcome. We take in visitors very seldom. It is not our usual custom, but this stay may help you solve your problem and your quest give you freedom.
You are both very kind to help this poor man find peace for his father. That is certain. I will try not to be a burden.
Come, sit at the table and eat what you are able. You must be hungry. I apologize if it is paltry. For that, I am sorry. This had best of potpourri. What we have, we must take from the sea early at daybreak.
The meal you prepared is excellent. You have great talent. I feel better already. Less weak and more steady.
Here is a cup of plum wine. It will help you to dine. Tell us more about what brought you here. How came you to suddenly appear?
My tongue holds secrets it cannot tell, lest it wake spirits that quite repel. But please, acquaint me with you. How came you here? What is your work?
I was born here, and so was my daughter. My family chose to live close to the water. My daughter is a pearl diver, and please God, a survivor.
I am interested in it. Please, tell me about the sea's habitat.
The descent is not hard, but you must be on your guard. The diver takes a rock and a knife. Below, the foam is menacing life. The plunging rock is an anchor, but a dangerous partner that takes you fast into the deep where the sea creatures sleep. The water is dark and quite cold. Divers must be strong and be bold. It is largely women who dive to keep their families alive. The men often find the water too chill and do not have the same skill. Not every mollusk has a fine jewel. Each day can be a triumph or a cruel.
Did you ever behold the sea dragon? Does he come without being bitten?
No, I have never seen him, though I have seen his cave where I swim. His effects are quite grim. He consumes those whom he catches alive, and turns away those who do not survive. Their corpses float up to the surface, their bodies all cold and lifeless.
It is a grim description you give of a spirit that is very repulsive. I shall try and rise early with you and learn what pearl divers do. It is time now for me to lie down, for I have traveled far to this town.
I shall lay out a straw mat. Please take our offer of that.
So on the next morning, when a new day was dawning, on a day when the sea was just right, they went as one at first light. Tamatori took Fujito where the sea waters grow. And the water is like indigo. The coves are quite steep. The caves below, very deep. She dived in for the sea's treasure, but on that day, the sea show its displeasure. Along the shore to find cover from the downpour. Huddling together to stay warm, there they waited out the storm.
Thank you, letting me observe your skill and your nerve, descending to such depth upon only one breath. Many lovers must come to woo a lovely swimmer like you.
I pay no mind for men. I prefer to hunt for the pearl again than to waste time in conversation and the want of flirtation.
I could not help admiring your form. I'm glad to be near you in this storm.
sorry I could not find you nice pearl that you could give to some pretty girl.
If you had given me such a pearl, I would have given it back to you. For you are the loveliest I've ever seen. And perhaps that ever has been.
Why do you flatter a poor girl like me? You are a gentleman anyone can see, while I am a child of a poor family.
You don't recognize your beauty within, and follow only your duty.
What I find in the sea sustains my mother and me.
I wish that I had your skill, that I might catch the sea dragon's gill.
Do not say such a thing. To hear it is frightening. No matter how skillful you are, you would never get far against such a terrible monster. Such an evil and dangerous creature.
Someday, when I am ready, I shall find a remedy. The time is not now. I do not yet know how.
Fujito fell in love with Tamatori. How beautifully she swam, and strongly. How well she spoke, and wisely. She judged him brave, not cowardly, yet he treated her very gently. Every day she went out to sea, he went with her, so entranced was he. They spent many hours together through all kinds of weather. Until one day, Tamatori spoke to her mother.
Mother, I'm going to marry. I love Fujito, and now carry his baby inside me. I hope that you'll agree.
It is a big step you are making, not a small undertaking. We know little of Fujito. He is still as vacant as a shadow.
I think that I know his heart, and that's the most important
his
part.
His heart? What is the heart? I suppose it is a start. I will not stop you. I give you my blessings too.
Oh, thank you, Mother dear. I need you very near.
Thank you.
lovers had been married. After all doubts had been parried and there was no further cause. Then, as happens, in due course, Tamatori gave birth to a son when her gestation was done. She was thrilled when he was born. But her husband was now torn. His father visited him in a dream, appearing inside a moon.
My son, I am glad for your marriage. But where is your courage? You have as yet made no stride, nor even tried, to find the dragon's nest, where he has possessed a pearl needed for my rest.
Father, I have not forgotten what the sea dragon is ill-gotten, but his home is very deep, and in a well-guarded keep. How am I to get the enchanted jewel, and survive from such a duel?
My son, we must find a way. What will your son say when he is grown and it is his day? Will he, like you, stray?
Father, you are right. And I need a plan to save myself and our clan.
The old man smiled and vanished. But his words were not extinguished. Was mine. A spark flourished.
My dear husband, what is wrong? That your face is so long and your glance is sidelong.
My father came to me in a dream, chided me that I did not seem to face the hateful sea dragon, and turned the sea crimson with his violent blood.
Pay no mind to a ghost. Your son now should be uppermost. We must raise him to be strong and not to do wrong.
How could I set an example if I am unable to carry out my father's wish and relieve his anguish? It would be as though I had lied and cast my dear father aside.
It is not clear how this arose, that the dragon upset his repose. You have never told me this story. Tell me now to relieve my worry.
The Emperor of China sought my sister to become his consort.
Your sister is married to the Emperor of China? Then you're not just a wanderer.
My family name is Fujiwara. The Emperor of Japan chose my father to become the head of our clan. And I am the next kinsman to become that great nobleman.
Why did you marry me? I'm not a fine lady.
I married the woman I treasured most. The one I treasured and cherished.
I do not have fine manners and know only the swimmers with whom I go out every day. What will your family say?
They will have no say in it. They will have to accept it. I will bring them a wife and a son. And before I met you, I had none.
We can take this up later. How did you become plotter to the sea serpent's slaughter?
Though my sister lived in a foreign state, her love for her father was very great, and he did this love reciprocate. She wept when she learned of his fate, and became quite disconsolate. This caused the emperor great distress, and in his graciousness and wish for her to convalesce, he sent to Japan a beautiful pearl, obtained at great peril from the depths of the ocean. It had the power to soothe the emotion, heal the grief of a soul, and make it once again quite whole. He wished to ease the care of her daughter by giving rest to the ghost of her father. It was a sign of his favor. But sad to say, the sea dragon learned of the galleon to carry this precious token meant to mend the hearts that were broken. The monster, angry that someone had stolen the prize from his garden, vowed to recover the beautiful pearl. He sent a wind to stir the sea into a swirl, and the storm he sent sank the ship on a sandbank, and he carried off that beautiful jewel. For the sea dragon was very cruel. He carried it to his cave, deep in the sea, where if I can find him, it'll be. But I've not been able to find him, no matter where I do swim.
That dragon lives deep in the sea. Those that find him must flee, or are consumed in his palace, and never reach the surface again.
It is a terrible description you give of a spirit that is very repulsive. But my purpose cannot be dissuaded, and my task cannot be evaded.
I see that your intention is set, and that you feel a great debt to your father even still. But your errand gives me a feverish chill.
I must find a way, or I will be unworthy today.
He's much more stronger than you, and very hard to subdue. A man cannot fight with a spirit. Your strength is not commensurate. It will be necessary to win by guile, and even then it could be futile.
What plan do you suggest? Do you have an idea that would be best?
I know where the sea dragon lives. His cave is very distinctive. I have never dared enter it just for some casual trinket. You cannot reach the entrance. Your lungs haven't the endurance of pearl divers like me, who dive every day into the sea.
How could one recover such a treasure? Surely it would provoke his displeasure.
Yes, it is quite true, and one could not escape if he knew. But if he can be lulled into sleep, then maybe I could escape from the deep with the jewel in my clutch, and that would be worth much.
How could you put him to sleep? That is a very big leap.
In his garden in the sea, the sea stays out by his decree. His garden has wonders to see, but he lives like a refugee with no one for company.
How could you make him so senseless that he would be defenseless?
I will sing him a lullaby to unlock and mollify his greedy and savage heart. And when my art has progressed and done its part, I will seize the jewel and flee from the vestibule.
What about the sea creatures? They're part of his cave's notorious features. How will you escape from them? How will you conceal the fine gem?
I will pull on a silken cord, which you will have on board the boat from which I descend. While the other end I shall have securely tied about my waist and at my side. When you feel a quick pull, you'll be happy and joyful, and with all your strength, you must pull the rope's length and raise me quickly to the surface, for I will be defenseless. But once I'm in the boat again, he cannot reach me then.
This plan is too dangerous, but the sea dragon is monstrous. Your offer is very generous, but I can...
Husband, it's the only way, and it does outweigh any other plans considered today.
We'll be taking a very large gamble, and it makes me tremble to think that our son and I might lose you. It is something I could not endure.
I will be down too deep to pursue and too deep to rescue. But promise me this, to make my son your heir, if I should not be able to be there. Promise me that and swear.
Promise. Swear it, and nothing shall change it. You will succeed me as the head of our clan at the end of my earthly span.
Good. Now let us prepare for the boat and then set it afloat. But first I must say goodbye to my son, then our task will be begun.
Tamatori went to her son. She frolicked with him and had fun. And she stayed with him till he was done. Her mother then took her grandson. And Tamatori, parting and alone, from her lips came a soft groan as she turned now to the unknown. Towards the shore, towards the sea, where she knew her lover would be. There, they embraced tenderly.
My dear wife, do not risk your life. I do not want to lose my precious wife.
To live or die is God's will. Ours, our destiny to fulfill. My life has come to this peril, where I alone have the skill. No life is ever tranquil, whether its end be good or be ill. But know this, I will love you until the sun and the moon stand still. Waste no more vital time, for the sun is now in its prime.
I have assembled a willing crew that can best help us get through. They know the sea and what to do. They will be steady and they will be true. And they won't fear the sea dragon or his retinue. And we will do our best to rescue.
Help me now into the bark. We must have time before dark. We want no troubles with the shark.
Now.
Overhead I see a lark. May it bring good luck as we embark.
Now with you on board, we can move forward. We can hunt for the dragon's souvenir. Find out where he disappears, the place of his hidden frontiers. Sailors, push off without fear. Let us all be of good cheer. Sailors, ship your oars. Below may be the wherefores to his gardens on the sea floor. This is where we will explore.
I will tie this rope around me. And when I'm under the sea, I will pull on it one, two, three. And then you must pull me from the sea. And then you must pull me very fast, or he'll catch me at the last.
What else do you need to accomplish this thing?
I'll take my knife along to protect me if I'm wrong, and I can't soothe him with my song. I know he's very strong, and I do not belong in his cave, so I could be singing my funeral song. I also need this heavy stone that will take me down to where the dragon has his home, and I can surprise him all alone.
You know this place better than I. Don't forget that we are nearby and are a very strong ally. If anything should go awry.
Husband, I shall see you soon, if our plan meets with good fortune. And we recover that pale moon.
Into my garden, and for what purpose all of a sudden?
Mr. Dragon, you're such a handsome man. Why, you could be Emperor of Japan.
I am a dragon, not a man. Please try to remember it if you can.
Of course, how silly of me. But you're as handsome as anyone can see.
I am not known for being pleasing, but more often for displeasing.
I am sure that if others knew you well, you would cast quite a spell. Ladies like me think you compel and would be happy here to dwell.
No one comes to this cave unless there is something that they crave. Coming here was very brave. What attracts you beneath the wave?
You must think me very base to think I have designs on your space.
Perhaps you think these treasures are unworthy of your leisures, that they could give you no pleasures.
What you have is very nice, but it does not much entice me. Some clams, a conch, and cockle shells, but nothing really that excels. I think on the whole it oversells the master who dwells here, where the diamonds, rubies, gold that the finest gardens hold, if the owner has wealth untold.
I have those. There's many a ship that I chose, and now do here below enclose. Don't be so quick to suppose that of everything I dispose.
Well, do you also have pearls? Or are they just for pretty girls? Maybe the oysters hide them from you. It wouldn't surprise me if they do. And maybe the truth is, you never knew. Or you have some I can view.
The oysters must give me their best. I give the pearl divers some of the rest. Now you would not be such a guest. If truth be told, I do them all detest. But you seem very self-possessed, and I am mildly with you impressed.
Why, thank you, sir. You're most gracious, and you're surely perspicacious. It is true that I have been audacious to discover a dragon so vivacious, and also one quite voracious. Coming here was spontaneous. You, sir, are quite flirtatious.
So let me ask you once again, why came you here? For what and when?
How do I know it is so? You have fine pearls to show. I'd like to see them before I go. Do they really have a lustrous glow? Or is your boast entirely hollow? And all of this just more bravado?
You, I find, quite bothersome and exceedingly tiresome. Soon you'll find yourself unwelcome. Must I become accustomed to such skepticism?
Pardon me, sir, if I err. Please do not take it as a slur. I promise it will not recur. I just wanted to see the treasure of a renowned connoisseur. Would you be kind and show it to her?
Well, if you put it that way, then perhaps I may. But you must longer stay while I assemble this display. But if I do, how will you repay?
What price would you ask of me? I haven't the wealth of the sea, nor am I a fine grandee or a wealthy legatee. Please tell me this poor payee.
You may propose a payment, and I will decide as the claimant. It is suitable or deficient.
Very well. Let me see. I could bring you honey from the bee. I can engage in repartee. I could stitch a fine filigree. Or I could sing very pretty.
I have no desire for honey. It does not agree with me. And with your words, I mostly disagree. The squid stitches all my filigree. But if you could sing very pretty, that I think would pay the fee.
I'd like to see the jewels first, for in the tricks of dragons I'm versed. They often fool you at their worst and make you fall down headfirst so they can enjoy the teary burst.
Well, I'm not one of those, but I'll do as you suppose. You have your reasons, I suppose. Observe the treasures I disclose. See the gold that I enclose. Here are my rubies, red as the rose. And here the emeralds that I chose. Here there are diamonds in repose.
Those are beautiful, just as you said. About that you have not misled. They would be desired by anyone not dead. They would stand one in good stead. And yet, there are no pearl spread.
No.
Do you keep them in another bed?
Why so interested in pearls, my dear? Is that perhaps why you are here? Your fancy words all insincere? You are not really as you appear, but rather, perhaps, a privateer!
Oh. I am weak and you are strong. To me, these jewels do not belong, and to take them would be wrong. If I were to flee, it would not be for long, so it is better that I go along.
Yes, you are quite right, and I will keep you in my sight. I'll show you what will excite and dazzle your eyesight. Observe me and be polite. This will be the highlight! Ah.
Such beautiful prizes, and in so many sizes. They're all like moon rises that a poet rhapsodizes. Why hide them from view? Why make seeing them taboo? Is there no one that you'd like to show them to?
There's no finer collection anywhere. Not in the sea nor in the air. And of all of them I take good care, for they are very rare. They are very, very rare.
From touching them I must forbear. I would love to wear them in my hair or above my shoulders as neckwear. They would give anyone a flare, and none to these do much compare. How sad they lie in solitaire.
So now you've seen my treasure. You promised a song for my pleasure. So please, perform it at your leisure.
Wait a moment, if you please. I think the show was a tease. Where is the one that you did seize from the ship of the Chinese?
How did you hear about that? They took it from my habitat. Why should I be just a doormat?
I heard it from a refugee who gave me his guarantee. That one too I'd like to see. Or you'll break your word to me. Do you withdraw your warranty? Then from performing I'm free.
All right. I must. But I do not think it is just that I must satisfy your lust to see what is in my trust.
You speak of what is just. Was not your robbery unjust? You did not steal a crust, but what is rare as star dust.
I only took back what was mine. And I think that you do malign, and that you misassign such a devious design.
So tell me, where is it now? Can you show it to me somehow? Or is it something you won't allow? Is it something you now disavow?
All right, I will do as you wish. You are a most annoying fish. I find you very churlish. Oh, it is a prize I do most cherish. But if it causes you such anguish, then I will not be hoggish. I keep it in this starfish dish.
Shining through even in the night. Who was the magic millwright that fashioned this wondrous delight? It will any loss requite.
For any injury, it is a balm, and to the soul produces calm. I'd seize it again without a qualm. Never let it come to harm.
Yes, I can see it is magical. To anyone not cynical, it is a mystic vesicle. It could free one of any obstacle, even produce a miracle.
Dragons need no spectacle. nor have they need for miracles, for they themselves are magical, and even sometimes diabolical.
Oh, my poor sea dragon. You can be such a demon, but today you have won, and I have come upon beauty in your salon.
Ah, I have kept my part of the bargain. Now it is your turn to do the same, if you are truly genuine. Or is your singing something that has since taken wing?
I will sing you a lullaby that makes my baby sigh, dries the tear in his eye, and makes him my ally. I hope that it will satisfy.
Very well, proceed. Please perform as we agreed. I'm glad that you conceded and with your words did not mislead.
Must find the jewel, or I have been a fool. My escape will be a duel against his guardian sea creatures with their ugly features. To make my departure, I'll need my dagger to be their destroyer. This rope summons the pearler, and my husband, the captain, telling them I'm in danger against such serpent alien. I dare not to be a straggler, lest he find out I'm the burglar.
Thank you.
Wished. You've been too unselfish. This wound is dire and hellish. I shall go into the sea and kill all the fish. Even the sea dragon will I extinguish, the one who caused this anguish. These things will I accomplish.
Nola, that is not what I desire. By my hand did I this wound acquire, to hide in my body the fire. And bring it to you, sire. Even if I die, which I hope it does not require, and I give up the sky, perhaps my son one day will inquire and find it something to admire.
Love of my life, do not leave me, my wife. This cruelest knife, that it could cause me such grief.
The knife was means, not an end. It did not offend. Your anger must give way. Your complaint must amend. It did my pursuers offend. And allow me this day to give what I did intend.
She asked her husband not to hate, and his passion to subjugate, for his task was to repay and raise their son to his estate. His father's spirit propitiated, and with that, her life did terminate. Her soul from body separated. Long after the funeral caravan, Fujito set upon a plan to take his son after a time and meet the Emperor of Japan.
Majesty, this is my son, arrayed all modestly, a boy born in obscurity, but not marked by inferiority.
I've heard his story, and know his mother's glory. For his loss, I am most sorry. She, for her brave deed, is a heroine all believe. To her son must we pay heed, and for him, I'll intercede.
And the Emperor honored that labor, always, ever after. And so did all of Japan. From the Fujiwara clan came the empresses of all Japan, the mothers of all emperors.